And you know that Jesus loves you.
Amen.
Just look around. I'll try.
All the kids coming up.
Okay, let's, wow, we got a lot of new guys today. This is good. Today we're going to do I'm going to sing a song to you because the sermon is about a classic story. One of those stories that you just say the word and everybody knows it. I mean, it's a story that everybody knows. I know you guys have probably heard this song. We don't sing it a lot downstairs, but I think you probably know it. It's the story of Zacchaeus. You guys know the story of Zacchaeus? What do you know about Zacchaeus? What do you know? Yeah. And I thought the first answer was going to be that Zacchaeus is a wee little man. That's what I thought you were going to say first. Zacchaeus, he was a wee little man, right? A wee little man was he. And that's the song. So everybody knows Zacchaeus. You know what the funny thing is, though? On my phone, I have that where you can text somebody, but you can actually talk, and it turns it into text. It's amazing because then you still can talk, but you don't actually have to talk to the person. It's great. And so I was texting Ron, but I was doing it over voice text, and I kept on saying Zacchaeus in there, and it just would not say Zacchaeus. It said Kia, then it said like Zacharies, and then it said, it was all these things, and I finally just hoped that Ron knew what I was talking about. You eventually figured it out, Ron, right?
I did.
Yeah. You thought I was trying to meet him up at like a pizza place or something. You know, is that the one on 3rd Street? But everybody knows Zacchaeus, right? What were you gonna say? Talk. Yeah, that's what I did. Talk to text. That was called. Thank you for updating me on my technology. I do appreciate that. So we're gonna sing Zacchaeus. Okay, who knows this song? Okay, so a lot of you guys know this. Okay, let's see if I can. Sound familiar now? Remember that? Zacchaeus was a wee little man was he. Climbed up in a sycamore tree, his Lord he wanted to see. As the Savior passed that way, he looked up in the tree and said,
Zacchaeus, you come down.
We're going to your house today. We're going to your house today. There's some other verses too. They're not as familiar, but they tell the story. Zacchaeus knew that he'd done wrong, sorry for his sins was he. For to the poor I'll give one half, all my goods said he. If I cheated anyone, 4 times will I repay. And Jesus said, salvation has come to you. For I've come to seek and save, for I've come to seek and save. This is a good clapping song, Dave. Good clapper. One more verse, okay? Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a happy man was he. For he had seen the Lord that day, and a happy man was he. There you go. Yeah, so the story of Zacchaeus. ended up following God's will because Jesus saw him and Jesus reached out to him. And that's what this story is all about. So we're going to learn a little bit more about that in the sermon, but I know that you guys have heard that song before, and I thought it would be a good song to share today. Let's bow our heads and pray. Dear God, we thank you for the stories that you have given us that help us to remember that you are constantly reaching out to us. You are constantly looking for us. We ask that you help us to notice, that you help us to receive your word and your love. And we also ask that you help us to show that love to others. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's go find your parents.
You may have noticed that in the bulletin this morning there is an insert that actually has a hymn printed on it. We are not going to sing this hymn, but when I found it, I thought these words are great and are in keeping with some of the themes that we're exploring here in our Lenten series. Themes of being created in the image of God and how in Christ's work in us that image is restored. And this hymn speaks to that. And last week our discussion got to talking about both personal ways that this affects us and also social ways where it affects our entire society and culture. And I thought that these words really addressed some of those same issues in a beautiful way. But there's no tune that I know, that we know, where we can sing these words. So I just wanted them to, for you to take with you and think about. And maybe if you find something here you'd like to discuss, bring it to the discussion period tonight. And we'll talk about it. I'd like to thank Jeremy for making the insert, because that was extra work for them. And anyway, that's what this is for. Our next song is one that the words we have sung before, the tune is very familiar, and some of the same themes are actually explored in it. So I'll play through the tune one time. You'll recognize it. It was even used in Bible school a few years ago. And it too has some of these same themes.
Praise to the King. receive our countable gifts, put them to use for the furtherment of your kingdom. You provided so much, you asked so little. In Jesus' name, amen.
And I know were scheduled for a certain time, then you had to wait, which is never easy, and you went to the surgery with a lot of just not knowing what was going to happen, what was going to turn out, and it turned out better than you thought, and there was that dip with the blood pressure, but the fact that she was up this morning walking around is a miracle right there. So continued prayers for Kim and her family as they go through all of this process.
Butch, I left Eric out. He had surgery this week on his shoulder. They were just going to take a spur off. Once they got in there, the tear that he had in his overcup, a little worse than they called, so they went ahead and fixed that. He thought he was going to have his arm in a sling for a week. Now he's going to have him in for 8 weeks.
So both spurs and rotator.
Yeah, a lot of prayer for sure.
Okay, anybody else? Lots of chill.
I pray this great country pulls itself together.
Togetherness, unity. Seems like we need that prayer a lot in this. Tracy?
I'd ask a prayer for a former co-worker. Her name is Susan Beck. She went home Thursday night from work to find her husband deceased.
So Susan Beck, is that a former co-worker of Tracy's? That would not be. Sounds very tragic. Prayers for her. Prayers for Susie's brother Kenny.
Dave. I spoke with Shannon and Tracy a couple of days ago, and Mike had his heart catheterization. They did not find any issue with his heart. So they're going forward with the hernia surgery later on this month. And they don't know what's causing his heart-like symptoms, but they'll get into that later on after the other surgery. Okay.
So prayers for Mike and Shannon as they look at this and continue to find out what's wrong.
Right.
Patty?
I have an unspoken request. And also, Aunt Shirley is improving. She's still not real steady yet. She still has dizziness, but she is improving.
Okay, Shirley. And unspoken.
And we are going to have a step-grandson born. He may be here now.
Maybe here now.
You may be here now.
Both cell phones will find out soon, right?
Yeah, I knew you didn't mind.
That's okay. That's okay. If you go off during, we know what happened.
There he is.
My teammate Terry had his kidney transplant on Friday, and they said it started working immediately. So he's in the hospital, I think, for a week, just making sure everything continues to work like they expect. But it's been a long time coming for him. So
continued prayers, but definitely a praise that it happened and it seems to be working. Anybody else? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you in a time of need. We come to you with hearts open, with some hearts broken, with some hearts in need of your love, in need of your understanding, in need of your wisdom. We ask that you watch over us, watch over those that are in medical need. We ask that you continue to bless their caregivers, their doctors, as they give them the care and the needs that they require. We ask that you are with the families of those people as they deal with the stresses and the heartbreak and the things that are happening. We also pray, God, for the people that need emotional healing. People that come to you with broken hearts, with broken souls, with troubles and problems that are in need of your care. We ask that you also hear our praises, because we know you are watching over us. We know you are there with us. And we know that our blessings and our praises come from you. We ask you, Lord, to continue to bless us, to continue to share your love with us. And we ask that you help us to help others. In Jesus' name. Her name is Sistine, and she was named Sistine because her parents met at, when they bumped into each other, and they were looking at the Sistine Chapel, and they met that way, and so they named her Sistine. And she's a new girl at the school, and everybody, and she thinks that everybody in the school is so backward and so dumb that they wouldn't know what the Sistine Chapel is. And there's this one boy, though, that's really interested in art, and he knows all about it. And there's this scene in the book where they're talking about that famous image of God reaching out to Adam, and Adam reaching up. And in the scene, God is reaching out to Adam. Their hands are almost touching, and Adam is kind of lounged back a bit. And ironically, the book that we're using for the Lenten series talks about this very, very thing, this very image of God reaching out to Adam. And the author, his name was Tom Berlin, he states that Adam is reclined, and the curve of his form suggests that he makes no effort to meet the Lord halfway. And you can see it in the picture there, where God's leaning out, reaching out, and Adam is just kind of leaned back, almost relaxing, almost nonchalant. He says that part of our restoration is that we have a posture problem. We seem to be leaning away from God at the exact moment that God is leaning in towards us. And it's almost like while God is leaning in toward us, we're reclined or holding back, kind of almost like we are examining our options. Last week we talked about how our lives are in need of restoration, how our lives are messy or broken. And this leaning back, this examining our options while God is reaching toward us, is probably how we got the mess in the first place. So today, as we continue to look at our lives and how we are in need of restoration, I want to focus on the grace that we receive from God that restores our lives, that restores our messes. So how do we get here? What causes these messes? What makes us need restoration so badly? Like we mentioned earlier, we are leaning away from God, deciding if we really want to go all the way in. I mean, other things get in the way all the time. In the Old Testament, they often talked about idols. There was a lot of mention of golden calves and things like that. They were the idols that pulled people away from God. Nowadays, we don't have too many people worshiping golden calves, but many other things can become idols for us. We worship what we think will bring us joy. We worship what we think will bring us meaning. In the book, the author quotes Martin Luther, and he said, "Whatever your heart clings to and confides in, that is really your God." So things like work or success or wealth or possessions or pride or ego, all of these things can become your idols. And they can bring happiness. They can bring happiness for a time. But these idols can move from bringing you joy or hope or promise to bringing you a mess. A mess in need of restoration. So a great example of all of these ideas is the story of Zacchaeus. He too worshipped modern-day idols like success, or like wealth, or like prestige. But God was reaching out to him, with grace, long before Zacchaeus even knew it. I'd like to read the scripture from Luke chapter 19. verses 1 through 10. It says, Jesus was entering Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector of the wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. It's funny when the babies burp that line. that wasn't right. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. And when Jesus reached the spot, he looked up to him and he said, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to be a guest of a sinner. But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times that amount. Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, because this man is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. So, the Jews during this time of Jesus had many reasons to dislike paying taxes. Their money went to support the Romans, who were pagan foreigners who occupied their land. It was collected by fellow Jews who had gone over to the other side, who were viewed as traitors because they worked for the enemy. And plus, the tax collectors were thieves, collecting more than they were required so that they could live in luxury from the oppression of their neighbors and fellow Jews. And Zacchaeus was apparently one of the worst offenders of this. He was a chief tax collector, and he was very rich. He was a short little man, a wee little man, for reasons that we do not know, wanted to see Jesus. He could not see over the crowd, so he climbed up in that sycamore tree to get a better view. It must have been quite a sight, a tiny little tax collector who everybody hated, up in a tree so he could see Jesus passing by. And even more shocking than that was Jesus' response when he saw this man. Zacchaeus, come down, for I'm going to your house today. This is just like God reaching out to Adam. Jesus was the one who initiated the conversation. He could have passed on by to find someone more suitable. But Jesus called him by name, and he entered Zacchaeus' life, and he invited himself as a guest into Zacchaeus' home. Jewish religious leaders would have nothing at all to do with people like Zacchaeus. Jesus was different. Jesus was different. He blessed Zacchaeus with his presence, and the tax collector received him joyfully into his house. Of course, other people noticed what was happening. A man who presents himself as the Messiah has gone to be the guest in the home of a notorious traitor and sinner and thief. No self-respecting, no righteous Jew would ever do anything like that. He would be defiled by going into this house and eating with him. So Jesus knew full well who Zacchaeus was. But he didn't see Zacchaeus in those terms. He saw beyond Zacchaeus' past sins to see Zacchaeus as a potential true son of Abraham. And that doesn't mean that he was just someone who was descended from Abraham, like all Jews were, but he was someone who could truly be in a relationship, a meaningful relationship with God. So the people were upset that Jesus chose Zacchaeus. But before Jesus says anything in response to this, anything in response to those critics, Zacchaeus repents. He repents. Zacchaeus recognizes his need for restoration. He accepted the truth about himself, that he's a criminal, an exploiter of the needy. He says that he will give half of what he owns to the poor, and he will restore times four what he stole from others. He says that he will make things right, and he will right the wrongs that he committed. And in that moment, this mess of a man begins to turn his life around. He begins that process of restoration. Jesus accepts his sincere repentance. Because as that song says, he came to seek and save. He came to seek and save those who were lost, those whose lives are a mess. So to seek means to have the initiative. He is the one reaching out for us. To save the lost refers to Jesus' ability to see the potential in people and what they can be in a relationship with God. We need help with our restoration because we cannot save ourselves. And this is why God sent Jesus into the world. Zacchaeus knows that his life is a mess. He knew he needed to be restored. If he didn't realize that, he wouldn't have climbed up into the tree in the first place. Zacchaeus did not even have to ask for love or forgiveness or for mercy from God. All he did was climb a tree out of curiosity. But that was enough to begin to open himself up to the overwhelming generosity of God. And Jesus didn't shout words of condemnation at this man. He didn't judge him in any way. Instead, he blessed him. He blessed him with his attention. He blessed him with his presence. He blessed him with his care. When others complained about what a sinner Zacchaeus was, Jesus didn't join in the criticism. He didn't need to. Zacchaeus knew who he was, and so did Jesus. Instead, Jesus let Zacchaeus respond in freedom to his grace and his generosity. He let him open his heart and open his soul to his love and to his grace. In Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10, it says, God saved you by his grace when you believe. And you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done, so none of us can boast about it. But we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. So restoration comes by God's grace through faith. But it results in a life doing good. And this is exactly what we see in Zacchaeus. In response to God's grace, Zacchaeus' life has changed. Before, he was greedy, he was selfish. But he became a living example of the abundant love of God, freely giving half of what he owned to the poor and restoring what he stole four times over. No one told him what to do. No one required him to take these actions. No one had to because he had been transformed. No one had to because he had been transformed by the mercy, by the love, and by the gracious abundance of God. He had received a generous blessing, and then he gave a generous blessing to others. This shows the transforming power of Jesus' grace. Sometimes grace is misunderstood as an invitation to sin. But in truth, it produces a changed life. This is the nature of God's grace. This is the nature of God's love. Always searching, always seeking, and showing up at the right time to lead us from a mess to a place of light, a place of hope. And as we come to the table this morning, God's table, as we come to share communion, we are reminded that God is reaching out to us. We know that we are in need of restoration. And instead of leaning back, weighing our options, I pray that we lean toward Him. We lean toward Him because His love and grace can truly change our lives. Because that's what His grace does. It changes lives. Amen.
Yeah.